Hello. Welcome to the 2014-2015 final season event. Except we are having a sex slam next month. But that's the bonus event. This is the final event. This, for those of you who may not know why you are here, is our culminating competitive event of the entire season. So we've had 7 open slams. At the end of each slam, we have crowned 3 glorious winners and given them enough cash to maybe drive here again another time. And woo, right? Support the arts! So throughout the season, people have won. We have invited all of our top 3 winners back here tonight. We have 13 finalists with us going into the competition tonight. Woo! 13 very fine finalists. Toot your own horn, girl. We will be observing our pretty regular format. We will start with a brief open mic. We'll go into our fabulous feature. We have with us tonight, Ms. Ella Barton is here from Seattle. Woo! Very, very exciting. She has recently become part of Seattle's National Poetry Slam team just last weekend. So she is, I know. Now she's here with us. Because we're that lucky. Excellent. So, just a quick word to our finalists. I want to tell you what the randomly chosen order is that you will be going into this competition. And I just want to remind you that, you know, whatever happens with all these, like, numbers and money and stuff tonight, I hope that you have an incredible, like a genuinely incredible experience up here tonight. This is a very exciting opportunity, you know? It's just this whole poet thing. It's very like, you know, like I want it. Like I all of us want what you have to give just to remind you, you know? Like I'm here to like give you that love, you know? Like I'm gonna give you the love and you give me the words, I'm gonna give you the love and you give me the words. I'll give you this mic, you'll make yourself heard, poet. That kind of thing, you know? Right? Cause like I need those words. Yeah. I need those words. Need that love, I need that juice, give me that truth, poet. Hot off the page, hot on the stage, decision's been made, so let's just do it. Yeah? Good. Because, you know, the point is not the points, the point is the poetry. We always say that, but I think at finals it sometimes gets a little bit more like, oh, there's going to be enough money for dinner, maybe like twice, you know? So the tendency, you know, to get a little more focused on the point, so just don't, just we're so excited to have you with us. All right. Going into our slam tonight, we will hear from Isabel, Miranda, Jesse, Toby, Rob, Hannah, Nigel, Roxy, Amelia, Alex, Joseph, Dante, and Sarah. Warm it up with some open mic. And our open mic tonight, our 3 chosen open micers are Michael, G, and Tim. Thank you to everyone else who signed up. My apologies. It's a short open mic. So, okay. Let's welcome Michael to the stage to start us off. Woo!
Thank you. My name is Michael. I hope there's not another Michael thinking they'd get the open mic, because I've got it. You always fall asleep first, she accuses with a smile. Always is such a broad word. She invokes it like a natural law. A strange combination, inertia and gravity mixed to pull me into a quiet drift, while she fidgets, sighs, stares at the ceilings. I can't disagree, I do sleep first, most of the time. But I always wake up first. It's always dark. My eyes crawl through the air, try to focus this side of infinity. Time is the same way. Each minute loiters in the warm glow of the clock display until the next one pushes it off the nightstand into history. Lexi calls Mommy, Daddy, switches to Daddy, Mommy. It's her talisman. Repeated over and over, the freight train woke her. She woke me, and I can tell by her tone, she won't sleep again without some encouragement. I grope to find the door. The walls are rough, the knob is smooth, the air is fuzzy. Her nightlight glares at me. She hides with the blankie on her head. It's a prayer shawl for the chant, Mommy, Daddy. A drink, a hug, she's almost asleep. We talk about the toot-toot she hears. It makes a happy sound, I say. No, toot-toot has faces, her logical reply. Back in the dark, I lie down and listen. It's hard to say what faces a child sees in the rumbling of trains. I see familiar forms of those I'll never see again. The whistle stretches them out until they spin fine as spider webs. Then the vision snaps and memories float back on faded echoes from the train. I blundered through the spider's web, the past as light as air, left without an anchor. Friends don't have to die for me to mourn their passing. I'll never see them again, except in the night train that roll through my sleep.
Thank you. Wow.
Wonderful. Thank you, Michael. The seal has been broken. The poetry has begun. And I forgot to say this, but you observed it so perfectly. Open micers, please take no more than 5 minutes. We've got a lot to get through. And so either one, you know, more significant poem or two tinies is fine. Next, please welcome G Processor to the stage.
Dedicate this to my mother. The only thing a mother wants from their children is to, before they pass, to rest her soul, is to see that their children can be successful. I'm celebrating a decade and a couple of years of sobriety from a deep cocaine addiction. My cocaine addiction led me in prison. And while I'm in prison, I had a botched suicide attempt. And I'm in a rubber room, naked with blood on me, in a straitjacket, and there's this camera in the corner that's looking down on me, and I'm thinking about how my life has unraveled, and there's this camera, I'm wondering what if the camera had followed me like this last few years while I was on this coke binge. And then I came up with this poem. It's called The 25 Cent Show. The movie reel of my life plays before a crowd of family and so-called friends. Each scene panoramically highlights the little self pools and sin puddles I called life. Drinking, drugging, lying, plenty of crying, white knuckling, trying. Hotel toilet paper pilferer, barroom mug lifter, soiled panty sniffer, unprotected sex, addicted, enslaved to the net. The monitor's glowing light keeps me hypnotized and up all night, click, click, clicking the 24th letter of the alphabet. Unpaid debts. I'm smoking coke, mad. The deadest deadbeat dad. I know this shit is sad. But these just the subplots of my 25 cent show. My mother's cocoa-colored flesh mushes and pales. Her heart melts from the heap of her adult fetus. My dad is double diced by the dagger of my dirty deeds. Who is that man? My natural baby browns reflect crimson red. That's not me. That's not me. Lucifer masquerades in my frame. Food, family, and friends flip into foes, munching popped buttered corn and nosebleed rolls, clip by clip, bow by bow, capacity crowds hurl. We told you so. We told you so. My tongue pastes the roof of my mouth. I can't breathe. I can't live. I can't even die. Shocked spectators hush, then yell in rage. Any actor, director, addict, poet, better figure out when it's time to leave the stage.
Yeah. Gee, thank you so much. So good to have you with us again. The stage is getting hotter. By the time our finalists get on here, they're going to be like... internally. Excellent. Closing out our open mic and taking us into our fabulous feature, please welcome Tim Hicks to the stage. Woo!
This one's called A Tragedy in Three Acts, number one. There's no fucking reason they can't just make the effort, dumbass motherfuckers. Let them try this shit. All it takes is a fucking finger on the button and the window goes down. Reach into their fat ass pockets. Probably got enough toll change lying right there in the cup holder. Fuck, it is cold. I gotta get me some mud. I'm stuck, fellas. I'm stuck. What you expect me to do? You got a job for me, I will do it. No job worse than this shit. I ain't never gonna give you nothing. I got something and you're in trouble. That's for damn sure. Think about that, man. Man didn't even look at me. What's the matter with these fucks? Act two. Under a high gray cloud ceiling, 2:34 in the afternoon, a wedge of geese works its way south. Act three. Oh, man, I can't feel my toes. I gotta get inside somewhere. Wonder where Shorty's at or Jane. Bitch owes me $12. When am I gonna see that? Trickin' and drinking and nothing to spare for me. I never done nothing but be nice to her fat ass. And I'm standing out here like a fool with my money in her pants. I'm not in a fashion show here, you cunts. This ain't no fucking fashion show. I need some change, partners. You hear that? I need some change. This one's called Bedside Vigil. Raisins harbor secrets. More than any new grape, my love. And are more sweet. Smoothness is a memory only, but we are less fragile. We travel well. Will you go now? Is it time? The years are like days of summer that have spent their heat on our glory. I would not lose you, but you fade like autumn light. We always knew the glass would empty. Now the red stain of time's meager rations dries and sounds echo in the goblet. What am I to do?
Beautiful. Thank you so much. And I probably will be throughout the night reminding you all that we have a sex slam event next month. and that theme is very broad. We welcome you to bring anything to the table that fits that theme in your mind. It can be all about grapes. Love, lust, loss, romance, straight up erotica. It's our 118 plus event, and it's kind of our way to say goodbye for the summer. We take the summer off. We won't be back till October. So, you know, as it's warm out and you're doing your thing over the next month, just, you know, let it simmer, let it shrivel, whatever, you know, raisins. I meant raisin, you know. So... yeah, the sex slam was a lot of fun, and the thing I want to bring up, and I'm going to, you know, I'll be quicker about this, I'm making this a long announcement because I really, I want to get it in there, is that props, the one rule that changes at the sex slam is that props are allowed and encouraged, and that's something that I'm going to be a little more proactive about helping everyone remember because I think it's an unutilized opportunity, And anything can count as a prop, including another willing human. Nothing that, like, anyone's going to regret seeing, but, you know. Right, I'm just saying. Let that all percolate and then bring it to us next month. That means we're ready to come back with this Eugene Poetry Slam for reals. It's very exciting. So, this is the part of the evening where we do our door prize raffle, among other things. And what's exciting about that, like if you really realize what that means, this is the part where you can win something cool just for walking in the door. And by cool, I mean like...
We got an empty bag up here tonight, too.
That's what he said. All right.
Before we start, I just wanted to mention that anybody here ever heard of Trudy Botchery?
Yes.
All right, she's going to be our featured performer at the Sex Slam, where props are prompts. And the other thing I wanted to mention is we're in a crowdfunding campaign, and we have a little recycled hemp bookmarks up front that have our IGME at tsunamibooks.com Google. And we're trying to raise a lot of money, you know, for us, $55 million. And there's limited time. But everything that could, this will be by the front counter, it'll be around. And everything that is in this bucket tonight goes into our Indiegogo, and it'll say from the Eugene Poetry Slam. So it's modest, you know, but powerful.
By the way,
that is also what he said.
Yeah. Right.
That is one of our perks right there. That's from, was hand carved in Haiti, and a member of Special Forces. Please check that out here. Vanna, can I get scores on this outfit here just through a hand clapping?
Yeah.
Is that? Oh, look at that. I know whose that was.
I'm not
going to
sit on that.
Maybe, wait a minute. Here. Clean it out, for sure, and or you know, re-gift it as is. Could you hold this? There's some really nice stuff this time. Holy cow!
Wow, who puts this amazing bag together?
This is stuff that, you know, we just like doing that. The crew really likes it. Here's a hat, simply orange. I don't know what the... This, journal, lined journal. We have an empty pen in here for, you know, because most of you people text your poems around, don't you, anyway? But candles, lots of cards, condoms.
Yeah.
Oh, origami papers, very nice. Oh, and this. Wow, that matches. Whoa, man, you want to play on our team?
I do want to play on your team sometime.
William. William Burroughs, Diane de Prima. Let me hear it for who's heard of Diane de Prima in here. Very small. The greatest, the mother of performance poetry in America. Allen,
person going to win all this?
Allen Ginsberg and Ann Waldman, and they're all speaking about how to writers of poets, essential insights, so you can drive around and, you know. Yeah, one person.
Oh my God, the final gift bag winner of the season is going home with... Neat. Okay, are we ready?
Yeah.
Meh?
Someone named David.
Who's, I'm David.
There's a lot of Davids. 255-2344 phone number. All right. Yes.
Excellent. So not only is David going home as our winner tonight, but he's going home as someone who everyone knows his phone number. So if you know, Solicitations may occur. Sorry, and you're welcome. Excellent. Oh, you know what? I feel though that you were a little humble about that jar. Here's what I want to say about that jar. Look, it takes a lot of effort to go on the Indiegogo campaign thing, and you should, because the video is beautiful and awesome, but that's like a lot of steps. All you have to do tonight to support Tsunami through that means is reach into your pocket and put some money in that jar. It will go in and you will see the number go up on the Indiegogo campaign. You'll think, yeah, look at how my $5 turned into insert bigger number here. Woo! You know, you can feel like that's like, yeah, like that's a matching grant between what, 50 people here? That's amazing. And easy. And Tsunami Books is amazing and easy. And we need to keep being here.
Okay. Excellent. But I do encourage you to check out the page. It's a lovely video. And it is time
to meet our judges. Our judges make this competition happen as much as our poetic participants. So,
judges,
when I call your name to introduce you, please raise your hand to identify yourself so we can all thank you in advance before we start booing at you. And no, we're gonna love you so much. I really appreciate you. I know it's hard, you know. So, no, that's our Roxy and I. Roxy and I color coordinate and then put out different moods. It's a great strategy. Okay. It's like good cop, bad cop, only we're both just awesome.
Nicer.
I'm nicer on the outside. Excellent. Our first judge tonight, our Rock Galen Forster. Thank you, sir. Galen is qualified as a great slam judge because, one, he's done it a lot. Two, he loves all kinds of poetry. Three, he tries hard to be fair. Four, he hates score creep, especially his own. And that is how you do it. Thank you, sir. All right. Our second judge tonight is Bree Alexander. Yeah. Where did you end up? Bree, where did you end up? Oh, there you are. There you are. Excellent. Bree is qualified as a great slam judge because she's a sassy mama poet.
Uh-huh.
That seriously works, too. Our third judging team tonight, we have Max and Oblio. Oh, good. I love you guys. Max and Oblio, where are you? There you are. All right. Wonderful. They are qualified as a great slam judging team because they judge on the regular and they are benevolent judges. Again, oh, so qualified. Yay, thank you, Megan. I like that. In case the judging just gets a little too hot. Excellent. Thank you, Virgo. All right, our fourth judge tonight is Carla. Carla, where are you sitting? There you are, wonderful. Okay, Carla is qualified as a great slam judge because she has 10 years experience as a language arts teacher. She is lit and comp included. She loves poetry and she loves slams. Like, ooh, good. And lastly, we have our wonderful judging pair, Lisa Marie and Caroline. They are qualified as a judging team because they love the spoken word of our community, and everyone readying for tonight is their favorite poet, and you are all winners, they say. Woo! Okay, I'm gonna try to do this the fastest I've ever done it in my life because poets performing, I know you know how this works, and judges, you've all been here before. You've got your scorecard, Olympic style judging, invisible decimal place right here, poet finishes. I say flip, flip, flip as fast as possible. I'm gonna try to keep it really, truly quick. I know you're all, you know, you've got this down, so we're just gonna try to move through things. We've got 13 poets in the first round. We're gonna take it down to 6 in the second round, and then our top 3 winners will take home $150 and $25 tonight. Woo! All right. So, I ask that you keep your judging consistent as much as possible. What kind of rubric you create in your mind to do that is up to you. We often suggest 5 points for content, 5 points for performance, but you may define your own rubric as long as it is consistent. To help you do that, we will start off the competition with a sacrificial poet. That poet will perform as though they were in the competition, so you will have a chance to get your judging groove on, but they will not actually count in the competition tonight. So, poets, you also know what you are doing. You know these rules, no props, no costumes. You've got 3 minutes. After 3 minutes, 10 seconds, points will automatic. I know, sorry. Oh, did you miss that one? It's like a new thing.
What?
Yeah, we just thought maybe time limits. I know. the only rule that changes in the slam finals tonight from the regular competition, poets, you may repeat one poem that has been done here before on this stage in this season, but your other poem, if you have a chance to read two, must be fresh. We like to encourage the fresh work, but this is the one time in the season when we do allow for one of the two poems to be a repeat. In the normal season, we do not allow it. We like to keep it very, very fresh. So, before we get started, do I have any questions from my judges or my poets?
Ditch top, ditch bottom, average three.
Yes, sir. Thank you. That is how it works. For those of you playing at home, this gentleman has got your best interest in mind. You want to know what's happening. The scores you're going to hear tonight are going to reflect only three, although five will be shown, and that will be the three in the middle. No highs, no lows. It's kind of like, I don't know, Xanax or something. It's not like that at all. That was bad. I'm sorry. I hope it wasn't offensive as stuff gets said. Oh, thank you. I love the group effort of my bad memory. Excellent. As soon as you come up to the mic and begin speaking, poet, your time will begin. So please, of course, take a moment to adjust the microphone to the proper height for you. I want to make sure that your voice is heard clearly. The easiest way to do that is by turning this knob here. I know. If that is still proving difficult, though, just make little, flares in my direction, and I will happily come and do it for you. So please do take a moment to center yourself on stage and feel good before you begin speaking. I think we covered it, right?
Right.
Excellent. Okay, so to sacrifice herself on the altar of poetry, please welcome Christina Jackson to the stage. Woo!
Feminist. I know that there are beautiful beings with vaginas in our lineage, and that due to patriarchy we lose some of our privileges, so this is my plan to re-enter this. I will proudly stamp an unmarried miss at the beginning of my name. I am bound by shame not to forget my strength, but for those of you who have, I'd like to offer you a kiss. A soft kiss, granting you the right not to be ignored, while criticizing the denial of prostitution being about independence or her truly wanting to be a whore. Whores, after all, give it up for free. If she's being paid at the end, that sounds like a business transaction to me. Although my goal is not to glorify the selling of one's body. If that is what you took from this, well, that's your problem, pardon me. But if you catch my drift like y'all Twitters do, then follow me. And I will show you poems that were dropped in the... Ooh. And I will show you... Give me a minute. But if you catch my drift like y'all Twitters do, then follow me. And I will show you books that were dropped in the sand by women whose feet were unable to tell their story. How they helped build this world with all of their guts but have been denied some of their crowns and glory. And how each day I am reminded of the strength of the she's and the relentless way that she fought for me. She made it possible for me to date women and hold their hands in public. Gave me an ability to read and write and all in your face to rub it. To feel so close to life that I see a big tree run up and hug it. To give her name and a shot and sit on the front of the bus for them to mug it, and the consequences are abundant for a woman who is determined to be in control of her own life. She might be called a bitch, a cunt, a lesbian, or a dyke. I am here to dispel the myth that feminists don't come in all types. We are black and Hispanic, native and white, Asian, moderates, leftists, and rights. It is not possible to know the woman unless you have followed her on her flight. Please turn off your television and stop listening exclusively to what you see in the media. You are responsible for what comes out of your mouth, so you'd better be mindful about what they are feeding you. I need you to elevate the dialogue, catalog the facts, start with the immortal life that Henrietta lacks. Yeah. Gloria Enz Al-Dul and Shori Moraga built this bridge on their backs. Get hooked and ring some bells and pray to Audre Lorde, because ignorance in this life is what we truly cannot afford. Let the reality of your presence re-wake you through your pores. Saturate the soil of your soul. Be needy, be greedy, read books in small nooks. Cook, clean, and feed yourself. Build your own empire. Plan to win. Try plan B. Be everything. Be the church and the steeple. Be the Americans and the people. Bring the heat and the cold. Be the broth, be the bowl. Be the bitch, be the hoe. Lead the teller, be the bold. Lead the sightless, be the told. Wear cream. Overthrow politics that say you don't belong. Throw stones, go big or be owned. Recite the lyrics of this poem, but write a story, and you will know more about hers. Know her story, and you will know more about yours, feminist.
I think that got it started. Thank you so much for that sacrifice, Christina. That we are sick. Okay, so judges, this is the part where you land on a score. In 1 second, I'm going to ask you to put it up in the air. I want to make a public service announcement. I forgot. A little page was found on the ground. I have not read it because it might be someone's personal stuff. It's got wonderful, cute little handwriting. And okay.
Good. Yes.
That's the first time I've ever gotten to do that. That was like the best announcement. Not like, there's a car with the lights on, you know, like... 8. Okay, judges. 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please. Show me those scores. I've got an 8.0, an 8.2, another 8.2, an 8.7, and an 8.9 for Christina. Let her hear it. $24.75 after a little time penalty. All right, judges, consider yourselves set. Feeling good? Okay, excellent. Let's do this. Let's start the slam competition proper. Here we go. On deck is Miranda. Please welcome Isabel to the stage. Isabel!
Called Things I Learned in College. I remember when college taught me how to smoke cigarettes, drag long and look bored and say yum. Don't let on how you don't recognize who you are when you do this, how you wish there were any other reason to sit with someone alone on the porch to be alone. In college, I've learned about signing my emails with best. I've learned that when you go to enough college, people have to call you doctor, even if you fix nothing. Something else I've learned is how to take a slap in the face as stand-in for tequila chaser. Oh, 1 second. Oh, no. Okay, I'm gonna go get it. Fuck the time penalty. All right. I know now that the quiet of the bathroom at a party is a holier place than a church. I'm not taking a shit. I am looking at myself in the mirror and looking and breathing and looking. I have learned enough guitar chords in college to pass as a hot girl. The porch is crawling with them. Hot girls. Who can trust them? Before I came to college, I thought that I would never call my mother. Across the porch's railing, see the sweet kid I have bummed this cigarette from. He tries to light it for me, but see, I have already thought of 20 euphemistic ways of saying, sweetheart, all the soft parts of me are now deaf and dumb from a litany of love I was too young to recognize as acting. College, I don't want to be alone anymore. College, can you teach me how to be alone? You told me once, don't fall in love with truth. At the doctor's office, I check the box that says not a cigarette smoker, never been a smoker. I am great at that kind of thing. I am perfectly fine with confessing I smoke weed. College has instilled in me an Instagram aesthetic, a skin thick from 30,000 side-by-side comparisons. College, you parasite, sucking the blood of all of my somedays, meat market shopping for the perfect bloody cut, the one who is finally loveless and pretty enough. College, you poor soul, so starved for attention. Even your microbrews will leave the floor sticky with filth. College, you have turned out my pockets and you still act like we're homies. Sometimes at night, in the deep alone night, drunk without you, I sing in the kitchen and make tea like we used to. Well, they picked me like a chicken bone and they think I'm half insane, ma. Look what they've done. And college is sitting across from me this time on the porch. He is handing me a cigarette. College, I say, I know you from somewhere. Maybe we met back in college. You don't remember, he says. We were in love once. But I am too busy pretending I'm just having fun. One thing I learned in college is to never let your heart break. One thing I learned in college is to never get your heart broke. One thing I learned in college is to never let your heart break. Thanks.
Audience, I love every effort you're making to take Ella's advice. Keep it up. What'd you do? yes, yes. Okay. Yes, okay. Thank you for your loud lovemaking to this poet, you know, and all of the poets, metaphorically. One of the few places where you just get to be like, yeah, I like that! Give me more of that! You know, it's good. Like, in public, I mean. That's what I'm saying. It's a very special opportunity, so, you know, use it.
Yeah, you mentioned Xanax earlier. The crowd needs to...
Yeah, yeah, it's great. I mean, no, I think we need a lot of permission to be loud, so I...
Some people don't.
Some people don't. Excellent. All right. Scores for Isabel. First poet in the first round. Up and at me, please. Judges, you are excellent. Thank you. I've got a 6.4. Boo! And a 7.8. Boo! And an 8.4. And an 8.7. And a 9.4 for Isabel. Let her hear it. Excellent. All right. On deck is Jesse. Please welcome our second poet to the stage, Miranda. Yeah.
I can read the distance between us like it's the only language I have ever been fluent in, and still I will never speak distance so skillfully as you. Hope, it does not seem to like it here. You see, my heart, it is an open casket buried in this chest, while your body, it is a sailboat made to leave this shore. So I will watch as your silhouette fades like sunset, like new moon tide receding, leaving naive, stranded in air it cannot breathe. And I will want to hold on like midnight clings to shadows in the violet face of a quickening dawn. But I grew up afraid of drowning. My body, it trusts this ground like the Manhattan skyline trusts the horizon. It knows this earth like casket knows burial. Do you remember my open casket heart? I have already forgotten my funeral. And my body can only become wreckage under your salt tear sea, while your body, it is a sailboat. But your heart, it is a dying star, and I will never be a physicist. But I don't need to be a physicist to know selfish, to know conceit, to know that a black hole is only dangerous if you get too close. It's not safe for me to stay here. So near to your self-absorption, hope is like drowning. It is a deceptive thing, and this is the tipping point in your collapse. There is no known force in the expanse of this universe, no magical thinking that can stop your implosion. For the laws of physics don't work under the weight of your own gravity. Do you remember your black hole heart? You have already forgotten my funeral. And I was a fool in thinking I could reach beyond your event horizon. So my body, it is suspended, stretched thin in this space like the time that bends itself around your becoming. My wreckage, your sailboat, caught in a stop-motion film that forgot to move. A stop-motion film about drowning.
Thank you so much, Miranda.
Oh, and the whole thing's gonna be like this. Yeah. I know. So good.
All right. Although, you know, my opinion doesn't exist because I'm this. So, those of you who get to have an opinion, the brave ones with the scorecards, up and at me, please. Excellent. Okay, I have got an 8.0 and a 9.0 and a 9.1 and a 9.4 and another 9.4. Thank you, poet. 27.5. Look out. All right. On deck is Toby. Please welcome Jesse to the stage.
You may recall, as a bright and beaming youngster between the tender ages of 7 and 16, the long-awaited gift of an antique book, simply titled On the Orientations. Within its cracked and bleeding pages lay the secrets of every last remaining gender expression, sexual affiliation, and sexual orientation, though without fail, the last copy of every part of this ancient tome is almost systematically removed before the owner may peruse it. The elders say, the last page is titled Asexuality and You. This lapse in our collective human understanding has plagued many a young explorer, and every year, one such person will attempt to bridge the gap between the known and the disremembered. So take hold of your anti-invisibility cloaks and your hardware store armor. And should you manage to peel back the veil of reality long enough, you will find us with the bi and pansexuals playing volleyball against the Easter Bunny and Herschel the Hanukkah Goblin. Once you have encountered the mythical ace, you will have questions, be warned. You will sound like an idiot. And there is nothing you can do about it because we've heard them all before. But still, we know you've come all this way. And honey, you just look so tired. So we will roll our asexual eyes and click our asexual tongues and wave you on with a weary asexual hand. Get on with it, we'll say. But have you ever tried having sex, you'll ask. And some of us will say yeah and moonwalk away, and some of us will say no and backflip down the hall. But how do you know you don't like it unless you've tried it? Or what if you just had really bad sex to start with? And some of us will say that you don't need to inhale salt water up your sinuses on the regular to know that you don't want to drown. And some of us will say good sex, bad sex, blue sex, red sex. It's like asking about the palatable difference between a saltine and a piece of drywall, because really, who wouldn't prefer cheesecake to either? But something had to make you this way. You will cry in your impotent rage with your fist beating the ground. I mean, what happened? Where did we go wrong? Who hurt you?
Oh my.
You will then be punched in the jaw. We have known too many survivors, we will all say, some of us among them, some of us lucky enough to be counted out. It is not your job, stranger in an ace land, to judge our level of corporeality by the amount of times we have laid under a stranger's roof, dreaming of home or Netflix. Your job, O wide-eyed wanderer who has stumbled upon our lair, is to take your newfound knowledge out into that bright world and never again fall prey to the lies that you have been fed, that sexual awakenings are a part of everyone's life, that romantic relationships solidify our humanity, that the closest you can ever be to someone is always going to be defined by the distance between two bodies in a bed. But if after all this, you remain convinced that we are but a passing vision in your Midsummer Night's Dream of a life, we ask as one that you take that throbbing dick that you are so convinced we need and fuck yourself.
Never short on good advice here at the Eugene Poetry Slam. All right. Judges, let's have some numerical value on that art. 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please. Okay, I've got an 8.5, an 8.6. An 8.7, another 8.7, and a 9.3 for Jesse. Let her hear it. Thank you, poet. 25.1. All right. On deck is Rob. Please welcome Toby to the stage.
Yes. I teach you, my daughter, to spell, that two sounds make an object, that letters line up to form ideas. I teach you the rules. Q rarely leaves the house without her bestie friend, U. There's shortcuts and tricks. Dessert has two S's because you always want seconds. And of course, the bitter betrayals. Knowing how to write knife, write and knowing. There is poetry as well. The breathy H of heart is a sigh. The word chaos should actually be hard to spell. The E in love is silent, but the E in forever is spoken. And the S in sadness is the same S in smile as the same S in the movie title Scarface. I spell the word S-T-E-P, and you know the word. Like stepdad, you say, and I smile. Becoming a father, I have to think about car seats now, sugar consumption. 32 ounces of horchata cannot go in without coming out somewhere else at twice the speed. Fuck, I should have known that. What parent feeds their kid 32 ounces of horchata, a burrito, and two candy bars. I'm so fucking shitty at this. I have an intimate relationship with the kitchen counter, and I tell it my problems as I wipe it down for the 4,000th time each day. Oh, kitchen counter, I don't want to fuck these kids up. How am I going to do this right? It's not like there's a book on the subject. Apparently, there's like 1,000 books on the subject. But I'm in the trenches. I don't have the time to read a book about how to use a shovel. I purchase radio-friendly rap albums now, defiantly staring down the cashier at Walmart as he rings up Notorious B.I.G.'s album with the clean lyrics sticker. Ladies, love your kittens if you love Big Papa. Ninjas, grab your duck if you love hip-hop. I try not to laugh at potty talk, but damn, that shit is funny. And of course, as you can tell, I'm trying not to cuss. I substitute non-sequitur quasi-harmonic words for the bathrooms. I say fire trucker instead of motherfucker. I say son of a crumb instead of bitch. I say shut the front door to express G-rated incredulity. I say fudge me in the face. Well, you probably get that one. Naturally, this makes moms happy, which makes mom's mom happy. My mom gave up a long fucking time ago. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. But some days, I feel more like SpongeBob than Scarface. I feel like I have lost the ability to pick fights with other men and watch the political primaries. I don't know how to translate you horse-fucked, dumb-shit, cunt-face pookie and suck my dick into words that you won't repeat to your friends and teachers. You can still say them at church, though, honey. I have gotten better at censoring myself. Those instances where I'm most likely to slip up are those when I get really excited. Oh, Indy, look at that squirrel. In a majestic movement, the squirrel jumps from the tree to the roof. Holy shit, did you see that motherfucking squirrel jump the shit out that tree? Forgetting, of course, that jump the shit out that tree doesn't make any goddamn sense to begin with. The other instance is your perpetual refusal of bedtime protocol where I have to get all Scarface on your disrespecting ass. Indy, you'll need people like me. You need people like me so you can point your fucking finger and say, that's a bad guy. Well, this is the last time you're gonna see the bad guy like me again until morning, where we make pancakes and the shake of Mickey Mouse, and you love me again in the morning. In the morning, we make pancakes in the shape of Mickey Mouse. Pancakes is one word made out of two that you know how to spell, and as you drop the first one on the floor, you curse its descent with a cute little, oh shit, and I laugh, because I taught you how to spell that word and how to say it.
A man in the trenches does not have time to read a book about how to use a shovel. Put that on your fortune cookie and smoke it. Okay. All right. You ready, judges? I know, you don't have to spell anything. Here we go. 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please. Give me the numbers. I've got an 8.8. I've got a 9.2. And another 9.2. And another 9.2. And a 9.4 for Tobin. Thank you, poet.
Huh?
27.6. All right. Moving into it. Okay, on deck is Hannah. Please welcome Rob to the stage. Rob Bullitt.
We must all do our part to prevent the English language from dying a slow, humiliating death from boredom, redundancy, and suckiness. Woo! Countless other languages are more interesting, more fun, and just plain cooler than English. In English, my name is Robert Bolman. But in the lilting, sing-songy cadence of Spanish, I'm Roberto Bolman. We all knew French was cool when watching Monty Python Search for the Holy Grail. The guy said, I am French. Why do you think I speak this outrageous accent? Shit, even German is cooler than English with those really long compound words. And I know I've heard Hollywood Nazis rolling their R's saying, Sprechen Sie Deutsch? So, whenever possible, we should evolve the English language, freely creating new words. For example, even in formal writing, I will use words like gonna and wanna, even though they haven't been formally accepted by the Merriam-Webster or the Oxford English Dictionary. But we can create new words whenever we want. For example, jeet, which means, did you eat? J-E-E-T, jeet. or shall we? S-H-A-W-E, that's shall we? Or sko, S-K-O, let's go, or let us go. So the beauty of that is you're going to have an entire conversation that would have required 7 or 8 words with just 3 words. Jeep, shall we, sko? How cool is that? There are those who would view Africa as a dark and backwards continent, but how come that's where all the really cool languages with those various clicking sounds came to exist? While Spanish and other languages roll their R's with a little practice, we can also roll our L's. I would love to see us make more clicking sounds, you see? One area where we can really take the reins in saving the English language is with our own names. Names do evolve over generations. My generation saw lots of Roberts and Deborahs, and then the 70s brought us lots of Jasons, Jeremys, and a big sloppy shitload of Jennifers. In recent time... In recent times, there's been a tendency toward creative new agey names like Zephyr Moonbeam or Serendipity Vega. But how about strong, edgy names to reflect the uncertain times we live in? If I had a son, his first name would be Splujock. Now that is a cool name for a man. But then I'd balance the strong ejaculatory masculinity of his first name by making his second and third names Poughkeepsie Nunu. I would name my daughter Kliki Paliki Mloomla. Now, yeah, that would be a really cool name to name someone. And tonight, I'm changing my name to Glulandiklan Tripakagazibo, and I will mercilessly browbeat anybody who doesn't pronounce it correctly. We all have to do our part to save the English language. Thank you very much.
On behalf of your non-existent children, thank you. I do really like making up words. That's a good subject. Mm-hmm. How about bumier? One who likes to look at their own bum in the mirror. Right? Just saying. It's true. Okay. Here we go. Scores for Rob in the first round. Up and at me, please, judges. All right, I've got a 5.2, a 7.0. Be strong, judges. You're doing great. I've got a 7.9, and another 7.9, and an 8.4 for Rob. Thank you, poet. All right, we're moving right into the middle of the competition. On deck is Nigel. Please welcome Hannah to the stage.
It's appalling how young ladies have been acting these days. It's clear they need some instruction. So, we have instituted a system to help our impressionable young belles achieve their full potential. Obviously, we love you no matter what. However, the amount of love you are given will now be based upon a score. Only females under the age of 25 are eligible for consideration. Points will be awarded as follows. 1 point for long hair. Deduction for shaved heads, gauged ears, tattoos other than cute insects, acne, and or lack of makeup. 2 points for every bra size down the alphabet. -1 point for implant scars. 3 points for being a size 2 or smaller. Bonus point for every inch of emptiness between your thighs. 4 points for every time you look in the mirror and unconsciously pinch the fat above your hips. 5 points for every time you look at a fellow competitor and think, her ass has more lift than mine. Bonus point if you use this as motivation in your next workout. 6 points for being tan. 6 points for having toned abs. Penalty for having arm flab. Careful, ladies, double penalty for having too much arm muscle. No one's asking you to be strong. 7 points for keeping your legs closed. Bonus points for acting like you're experienced. Note, being a virgin will result in either penalty or bonus depending on who is judging you. 8 points for being tan. Deduction for having tan lines. Appendix, deduction for any lines, including but not limited to wrinkle lines, panty lines, boundaries. 9 points. 9 points awarded for wearing a skirt that a hand can easily reach up into. Penalty for pushing the hand away. 10 points for every position of submission. 10 points for every female friendship that withers under the acid rain of mutual jealousy. 10 points for every time a man makes you feel like there should be less of you. Count carefully. For 10 points, you get 1 minute of attention. For 20 points, you get one night of affection. For 30 points, you get the above two rewards plus a coupon good for one free therapy session. For more than 30 points, you win. You're perfect, undefeated champion if you hate yourself by the end of the game.
I was watching this female comedian recently talk about the thigh gap thing, which is still like a real, you know, and she, oh, it was so good. She ended her bit, and she took her pants all the way down, and she was like, the thing is, I mean, my thighs touch, they're touching each other. If I was this close to my pussy, I would be touching myself too. You can't blame them. I thought that was a pretty proper assessment. All right. Excellent. Scores for Hannah in the first round. Up and at me, please. All right. I've got an 8.3. Ew. An 8.6. An 8.8. An 8.9. And a 9.4 from Ms. Hannah. Let her hear it. All right, on deck is Roxy. Please welcome Nigel to the stage.
All right, I'm gonna have some fun, and you guys are gonna help me play along. That's what it says on this little piece of paper. When I point at you, you're gonna say 8 days a week. It's a Beatles song. Don't wait for it, just try to have fun with it, and we'll work on the timing. Ready, set, go. Wake up, go to work, come home, sleep. Job well done, well, hopefully. Forever endeavor, inevitably. Catered to the beat. Thank you. Monday, wanna run away if you can. Get with the program, stick to the plan. Tuesday, two-way traffic jam. Cruise through the middle, now who's the man? Wednesday, left lane, flying by. Halfway there, my oh my. Thursday, thirsty for turpentine. I earned it, cause I work for mine. Friday, try to arrive on time. Lines are blurred between earth and sky. Saturday, can't believe it's finally here. You find me hanging from a chandelier. Sunday, supposedly the day of rest. I make way for the rest and hope for the best. Transcend this mental mosh pit. 247 on a constant, forever endeavor, inevitably, cater to the beat. Words to live by, mighty heavy, prepare, get ready, quite honestly, I'm pumped like blood flow, blue like jazz, all jacked up and I can't relax, no love for the lyrical acrobat, no fun being everybody's favorite spaz, Irish car bomb, loaded flask, die hard walking on broken glass, hold my sign as the cars roll past, gold star work for cold hard cash, weatherman said it'd be overcast, now I'm soaking wet, balderdash, in the game, rain or shine, playing through the pain, saying it'll be fine, poverty stricken, below the line, praying to the almighty dollar,
father's sign. Since day two, stay true unto mine. Pick strange fruit right off of the vine. Don't just wake up, gotta open your eyes. There's a job to do, plus overtime. You got coal to mine and a path to find. You ever feel like that? Of course you have. Report to the lab and state your grind. Like wake up, go to work, come home, sleep. Job well done, well, hopefully. Forever and ever, inevitably. Cater to the beat. Monday, one day, I'll be the boss. Private runway, taking off. Tuesday, tacos, two for one. Half price, that's nice, you get none. Wednesday, crazy, sexy, cool. Maybe, but mama ain't raised no fool. Thursday, wordplay, chicken scratch. Read the ingredients, mix a batch. Friday, highway robbery. The price you pay for commodities. Rain check, train wreck, pain in my neck. Accept much less than you expect. Saturday, no excuse, come correct. Finger on the button like hunting peck. Sunday, fun day, you know the drill. If I don't do it, nobody will, cause I'm coming to your house door to door, South Pole to the North Shore, motor mouth without a doubt. I speak in code over and out. GoPro Mojo mass appeal when the man spoke like a wagon wheel of a warrior's philosophy, keeping it real. Frequently sloppy, freak what you feel. Good artists copy and great artists steal. Don't comment on my accomplishments till you peeked in the mouth of a crocodile. Walked a while in my moccasins, transcendence, mental mosh pit. 247 on a constant, forever and ever, inevitably. Cater to the beat.
I think that's what it felt like to be in the Beatles, right? Oh, yeah. It's interesting to get lost in thoughts about, like, when they were writing that song, could they have possibly conceived that that would happen later? Excellent. All right. Scores for Mr. Nigel in the first round. Up and at me, please, judges. Okay, I've got an 8.2, and an 8.4, and an 8.7, and an 8.8, and an 8.9 for Nigel. Let him hear it. Woo! All right, on deck is Amelia. Please welcome Roxy to the stage.
For those of you not in the know, a Brazilian wax is when an esthetician removes all of the hair from your pubic mound, your labia, your clitoral hood, and your ass crack. As we were learning this in school, a group of us gals decided to get some hands-on experience and practice on each other after school. And I was the absolute last to go for reasons that did not become clear until later. It wasn't until mid-wax when my friend cried out how lovely of a pubic mound I had, and I laughed so hard in disbelief that I peed the massage table. I realized that couldn't be possible because I thought my vagina was fat. I know, it's crazy. It's crazy. At no point was my pussy heckled. It wasn't just walking down the street and some construction workers were like, "Damn, boy, she got some junk in her cunt. My pussy is not on Weight Watchers. It doesn't have love handles or back fat. It's kind of just a vagina. But apparently, at the same time I was developing a complex about my back fat, my labia started checking for cellulite. And that's fucked up. And I got this feeling that I'm probably not alone in my pussy paranoia. So let me just say, girlfriends, you hold your Georgia O'Keeffe's up high because your pussy is perfect. There is nothing wrong with your love house. Nothing. If your pink palace is a little more rose than pink, if one labia's got a case of the dropsies, you go, girlfriend. I don't know what the Hindu phrase is for the divine in my fat pussy recognizes the divine in your lopsided pussy, but namaste, honey. Namaste.
Good. I know, I think that might be a missing part of the affirmation business. Breathe deeply and repeat after me. Also, I'm going to start calling it my love house. That's new. Just... Hey, you want to come over? Oh, yeah, no. A little party at my house. Okay, here we go. Those of you with the judgment, hold it up high. One, two, three, up and at me, judges. I've got a 7.8 and an 8. Oh, and an 8.2 and an 8.7 and a 9.0 and a 9.2 for Roxy. Thank you, poet. All right, this is gonna be a tight competition. Okay, on deck, we're in our about our last third here. On deck is Alex. Please welcome Amelia to the stage.
So this is one about trying to love somebody when you're actually in the middle of like a deep depression and kind of a nervous breakdown. Said the sun, and then the sun again, tapping itself on the horizon like a pen on a corporate executive desk and smacking its gum. You know, from where I sit, it's a pretty good view, and I can tell you this shit is mostly just a lot of wasted space. Best preserved as bastard sparkles, I say, but fuck. I may as well be God. And what are you? A little fuel for all my flames? A little less than clay? Tell you what. Lay low. Don't hope for nothing, never, but a good place to bury all your bones. And thus begins my impossible task of finding you. See, I don't know if you've noticed, but I'm long since broken open, stretched wide as my finger pads are blind but bright-eyed. I paw the airy spaces holding you and tear through that tidal tumult of your tongue, the seafoam of your lungs that stirs and breaks against the rock faces of your sentences. And in all this ballerina language, I'm still looking for a different kind of spinning. Something buried deeper, the beady bad eyes of seeds, the scent of blood left out for wild sharks of spring. And I suppose what I am asking is, how exactly do you manage to satisfy those lusty, lengthy vines in your spine? How, if ever, do you expect a doorframe big enough to welcome them inside the shitty arc we ride when most days there's nothing left of me but an aimless urge to build in a couple places where children spilled milk? But fuck it, I say.
I'll clench my teeth to fists and I will say you. I will speak your proverbs back to myself until they sound sweet. I will make you to a fossil. I promise I can preserve your arms forever in the minerals of mine, says I, always talking in circles all around my eyes as a toy train rolls through a county diner. It's 2 a.m. and I'm still pulling circles all around my eyes and thinking again about talking about it, but falling asleep instead behind a grand piano of my neverminds. And in waking, I think how Jesus Christ had wanted to. And in wanting to, I finally find that awful edge. It's like all there is wanting to, and I'm nothing but my intentions, and maybe we're all born doomed, damned to souls much too big for our skin, such that we'll always feel constricted by the absolute laws of fingertips that state something to the effect of, none of you will ever hold out any number of hands equal to or greater than that of the ocean. Moreover, while your spines may sometimes turn, they'll not pivot so pretty never as the folded shapes of wind.
Thank you, Amelia. So glad to have you back with us at the Poetry Slam. All right. Judges, I love how fast you flip those cards. It's working out very well. Show me what you got. 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please. All right, I have got a 7.9, an 8.2, an 8.5, a 9.0, and a 9.6 for Amelia. Thank you, poet. .7 is definitely going to be close. Okay, on deck is Joseph. Please welcome Alex to the stage.
So I'm in college, realizing that the internet meme Forever Alone has two typos in it. There should be a space between A and loan, and loan should be spelled L-O-A-N. Understanding that I need money, I start my Google search. Blood bank in Portland, Oregon. Plasma center in Corvallis, Oregon. Sperm donation in Eugene, Oregon. Did you know that a kidney goes for $262,000? I could live with one kidney. Skin is $10 per square inch. A gallbladder is $1,219. Who even knows what a gallbladder is for anyways, right? I do. It's to sell. Imagine I have so much to offer to the right buyer. So I put in the paperwork, got the permit, and reserved a space for an auction to buy me. I dressed in my nicest clothes, made the room a comfortable temperature, warmed up my body for the stage. You should have seen all the things you could have bought. Glittering displays of legs, feet, arms, eyes, everything must go. $5,000 for my sense of direction to the freshman always getting lost to philosophy class. $3,000 for my punctuality to the girl in the back who keeps missing the bus. $10,000 for my fashion sense to the boy who wears running shoes everywhere. Where are you even going? Why are you always running there? $12,000 for my writing skills to the senior who needs to get those English prereqs done. Nothing left except cold, hard cash. I am now the proud owner of $1.2 million. I can now graduate college without any debt. This is so much better. And I see my peers take suit. I see my best friend strip away her bite and venom, placing it gently into the claws of a corporation who promise her a promotion if she just takes them by the hand quietly. My roommate exchanges his running shoes for a pair of brown Oxfords, blue button-up, and khaki slacks. He's now working for a condo development that is slowly demolishing the park he once ran at. But the full belly of your pocket is something you want to get used to. The playwright that used to push controversy is now writing dialogue for commercials. The comedian who used to do 4 open mics a night is now selling edited jokes to a laugh reel. She used to sing the sweetest serenades, now reduced to the jingle of advertising. He was going to be a public defender, but now burns to people he swore to protect. with flaming sacks of $100 bills just because he can. But the chime of 30 silver coins in your hand is a pretty sound. This is far from your last supper. Everything must go. Nothing left except cold, hard cash. This is so much better, right?
Who says poets aren't good at math? Okay, excellent. Those of you with the numbers in your hands, 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please. I've got an 8.6, a 9.4, good, a 9.5, another 9.5, and another 9.5. Thank you, poet. All right, we've just got three poets left in the first round. On deck is Dante. Please welcome Joseph to the stage.
In the seventh grade, I performed the appropriate actions to transition from boyhood to man. I accomplished a feat of masculinity. I owned enough Star Wars shirts to wear one every day of the week and then some. Every morning, I would unfold one of those 100% cotton youth large bad boys and become a hero, an Anakin, a Mace Windu. Heck, I'd be stoked to even be an Ewok. With these shirts on, I was invincible, unstoppable, a Jedi master. My JanSport backpack was my R2-D2, and the gap in my teeth was my Padawan braid. Except one day as I walked down the halls of Pioneer Middle School, sporting clone troopers on my chest, Fletcher Smith looked at me and said, "Nice Star Wars shirt, faggot." And that was the last time I wore a Star Wars shirt, except once my junior year of high school, and I wore it to the Harry Potter Half-Blood Prince premiere, trying to be what I thought was ironic. But what scares me and what gives me goosebumps and what fuels my nightmares is one comment changed my life. What makes me nervous is that diversity is dead. As soon as they realize the Force is strong with this one, they call an Order 66 and make sure they are under their power. And I'm over here thinking, it's a trap. You want us to be different, but you hate us if we become a Jar Jar Binks. If you remember correctly, Luke had to stop looking into the box to save the day, but that box is a place I won't say I'm proud I live my life the opposite way. It's no longer cool to read. It's no longer cool to like school. It's no longer cool to be yourself. It's no longer cool to be a good guy. It's no longer cool to be a Jedi. Because life is a pod race, and everyone is betting against you because Sebulba always wins, and 29% of students who are bullied in school drop out, but I'm Han Solo, so never tell me the odds. There's something to be said that the Jedi fought with the rebels, the resistance, against the Imperials, the supposed good guys, the people who are supposed to protect us. You see, we're different, and we need to come together and teach each other, because being bullied became the Yoda on my back, training me to lift my starship up and down in the swamps of public school. What fuels my nightmares is that everything I need to know, I learned from Star Wars, but no one else is watching. People remember Darth Maul, but forget Qui-Gon Jinn. People know about Ted Bundy, Jeffrey Dahmer, Charles Manson, but kids today don't know what Malcolm X did. There's a lot of General Grievouses around swinging four lightsabers. But I don't need to tell you that Yoda had the smallest lightsaber, and he was still the master. And don't forget Jango Fett, because cloning yourself doesn't make you a good father, and it won't make your kids grow up any faster. What fuels my nightmares is that my lightsaber can block laser beams and blaster fire, but it can't block ignorance, and if you don't look good in a metal bikini, then you're not wanted. But the point is, Leia wore that because she was a slave, and we're enslaving ourselves every time we try to fit in a metal bikini, every time we try to fit in. What fuels my nightmares is one day I'll wake up with a message saying, "Obi-Wan, you're our only hope," and I won't be able to because I forgot how to use the Force. But then I realize I know how to use the Force. I am the Force. I was raised a Jedi with skinny jeans and banties, and someday I'll go back to the halls of my middle school exactly who I want to be. But this time with elevated thoughts, my ideas sky high like an X-Wing. But instead of destroying the Death Star, I'll be destroying expectations, destroying the Empire, and destroying my nightmare fuel. Yeah.
there's like a metaphor in there somewhere. All right, those of you with the power to raise the scorecards, up and at me, please. Home embassy. All right, excellent. I've got an 8.8. Ew! A 9.2.
I got too angry.
And another 9.2. And a 9.4. And a 9. Ooh, you doing okay? And a 9.5. Woo! Thank you, poet. Wonderful. 27.8. Yeah. All right, here we go. Two poets left. On deck is Sarah. Please welcome Dante to the stage.
I like you. See, I hope that we're at a place in time where I can say that, okay? I like you. See, I like you. I like you. I want to make sure that I can like you, that we can go out to coffee and be okay together. See, I like you. I like you like chocolate likes peanut butter. And if you don't like chocolate and peanut butter, that is, if you dislike it, then I'll sell all of it I own. See, if you dislike chocolate and peanut butter, then I'll sell all of it I own and we can buy something else to eat in the bathtub. This is my room. It can be your room too if you like. Do you need help moving in? See, I like that you like me. I think that we will do well in domesticity. There's a cafe on the corner. There is a church down the street. It's adorable. If you would like, I am carving out a space for you in my body. You can lie next to my lungs. It's nice and warm. See, there aren't too many places left that are warm. There are a lot of excavations in my chest now. There are so many holes in me that ghosts pass through me. But it's okay. It's all right. See, I gave that flesh away and we're okay. I mean, they're okay. I mean, we're okay. Do you like jazz? I don't like jazz, but if you like jazz, then I will try and like jazz for you. Then I will learn to play the trumpet. See, if you like jazz, if you like dancing, I see you dancing sometimes in the middle of the night. And if you don't like dancing, see, I don't like dancing, but if you like dancing, then I will break my legs into something that can dance for you. Because I like you. Because I want everything to be perfect. Because I want me to be perfect. I want kids. I do. It's a big thing for me. See, I want kids. I want to have a couple kids and raise them well and help them when they scrape their knees. And see, I want kids. I carry this want in me. It's a big thing for me. And I know that you don't want kids. And right now I'm planning to get rid of that. And see, the thing is, surprise, I don't want kids anymore. No, it's okay, it's okay, it's okay. See, I like you, I like this, I like this. I like waking up next to you. I like losing things for you. I like so many things, so many new things and the old things. See, I don't need them anymore. I don't need them anymore. I like this. I like being with you. I like losing things for you. I like so many things. I like so many new things. I like you. Please don't go. I like you. I liked this. I liked this so much.
Sometimes I feel stuff, but I'm not allowed to talk about it. You guys are allowed to judge it, though. Here we go. Scores for Dante in the first round. Up and at me, please, judges. I've got a 9.2. This is like I feel like if we were playing poker together, we'd win against ourselves right now. Watch what's about to happen. Okay, we're starting at 9.2. I've also got a 9.3, a 9.4. A 9.5 and a 9.6. 28.2. All right. Judges, I think that means you've achieved the group mind necessary to go forth. I think that was like the royal flush of scores or something. Excellent. Perfect. So, last poet in the first round, please welcome Sarah to the stage.
A letter to your couch. You're so uncomfortable, it must be a design flaw. Isn't a couch supposed to invite people to take a seat? But just looking at you makes me want to walk outside and sit on the concrete curb. I'd rather sleep on a bed of gravel for a century than sit on you for a second. They must have left something out when they made you. How you slipped past quality control is one of life's most mind-boggling mysteries. I would love to speak to your manufacturer. I have a few choice words for him, and they are not, have a nice day. I'd rather relax in a lion's den than your den. I'd rather sleep in a funeral parlor than your parlor. Call me Kafka. Because you're a surreal experience.
Yes!
A trapping of hospitality with none of the warmth. I can't complain about a welcome mat because of letters written in a grudging script. And I can't complain about the seating arrangement because of bumps and ridges cropping up out of the seat cushions like you were stuffed with cutlery and nails and knuckle bones. You wrap yourself in this flesh of domesticity, but underneath, you are a pair of jaws posing as a love seat, a piranha imitating furniture, a Venus flytrap shaped like a sofa. After all, wood envies flesh and blood, metal springs despise supple skin, dust hates youth. If I had been smarter, I would have made a new door in the wood paneling with you, carved 5,000 fuck yous into your upholstery, splintered your legs for kindling. I would have dismantled your frame piece by piece with my bare hands to construct a coffin for my hopes and dreams and last ounce of self-esteem, because then I could have at least saved myself some time. Everyone says not to take it so personally, but everyone goes home to plush cushions and feather pillows, and their eyes look like slam doors sound if I suggest a game of musical chairs. But forget the couch. A letter to you. You make your couch look like a bed of daisies. A letter to my former self. Run. I know you love the living room. I know you love the wallpaper and the clock and the rocking chair, but you can't let the couch sit on you. You will, though. You weren't supposed to be there, so you don't know when to leave.
Thank you, Sarah. Dust Hates Youth, band name of the night. I hope you go somewhere with that. It might be an album title. Whatever. Go big. Okay. Scores for our last poet in the first round. Judges, up and at me, please. Scores for Sarah. Excellent. All right. I've got a 7.1, wow. An 8.2, A 9.0. Okay. Another 9.0. And a 9.6 for Sarah. Thank you, poet. Twenty-five point nine.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll thank you. 25.9. All right. So that allows me to tell you who is going into the second round. We will take a shorter break than we did last time. I will obnoxiously try to beat you to the potty line, and we will get to hear again from Miranda, yeah. Toby, yeah. Hannah, Alex, Joseph, and Dante. Thank you so much to everyone. We're going to come right back with the second round and take home some cash. I'd like to remind you about Tsunami Books' Indiegogo campaign. Yeah. Important stuff, because we don't get to keep coming here if this, like, isn't here. It's actually very simple like that. So we have to throw dollars at the problem. That's what you do, right? Okay. So on the count of three, will everybody say, "I'm a tsunami of love"? The other announcement I would like to make before I let you all go is that we have a sex slam next month. I've said it before, I'm saying it again. So I'm putting those two concepts together. Tsunami Books, fundraising, love. You guys ready? It's going to feel good, because when else are you ever going to say this in your whole life? I'm a tsunami of love on three. Here we go. One, two, three. I'm a tsunami of love! Yeah, you are. Excellent. That's exactly what you want your audience to be. Perfect. Perfect, audience. All right. So, going into the second round, we're going to recalibrate. Can I just have a quick hand in the air to make sure that all five judges and judging pairs are ready to go? Here, 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 here. And you in the back. Perfect. Thank you so much for the light. Excellent. So we are going to recalibrate with a second sacrificial poet. Very exciting to get to hear from her tonight. She's been working hard for you all throughout the evening. All right. To sacrifice herself on the altar of poetry, please welcome Jane to the stage. Woo!
No, top one. It's
not like you work here or anything.
On the mournful middle class, the unloved child, uncertain black sheep, without sure drive like the first, righteous purpose like the last, the merchant, the didact, the communist, the foreman, the slave trader, the preacher. On the trembling referee, cowed between grappling arms of poverty and power in the center ring, fight of good versus evil. Oh, Benedict Arnold. Oh, Judas Iscariot, times, timeless scapegoats, you identityless wafflers, void of birthright, pressed to choose a side. Oh, worm tail and worm tongue, your sin the vice of self-preservation, fear in the face of forces fiercer than your convictions, scrapers after mocking masters, champions seeking help-wanted signs. Can we forgive these reckless children, snatching cookies from the fists of the youngest, trailing the eldest with whining pitch on his way to school? Too late for title, they watch siblings sent, unwilling to retread the ruts of heroes' journeys, surviving fire, returning legends overburdened with gifts of gold. Those dispossessed crying for cause, racked with self-pity, sent without name to military, to monastery, the ostentatious, the obsequious, the gadfly of every tale. On the whining of the privileged, for I am one, and so speak with Delphic fever, the anxious authority of those crowned kings on quaking hills. May we apologize at last for our wavering affections, our treasons and defections, our fickle alliance that gossips through loosely clasped hands, our judgment and prejudice, our boastful clamoring, first drunk at family gatherings, recounting ancient grievance, locking doors to weep in guest bathrooms, seeking unworldly identity in the fauna of mirrors, and at night's end, minds muddled and stomachs churning, crushed from both sides in this truculent tribal tumble, the deleterious dogpile dictated by tradition. No, self-loathing coats our tongues that orate from the soapbox of your backs as we wrench your arms, swearing we'll pull you free, though piece by piece, to feed you to the top.
Thank you, Jane. Yay. One of the amazing staff who make this place happen. I know, but you have to judge her poem, not her working all night. All right. Scores up and at me for our second sacrificial poet. 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please. I've got a 7.5 and a 7.8. And an 8.5, and another 8.5, and an 8.7 for Jane. Let her hear it. Yeah. 24.8. Also, Jane, remind me never to get on your bad side. I feel like you might have words for me. And I'd like to hear them. So, we'll see what happens. That was good. Okay, excellent. So, here's what happens in the second round. Last shall be first. So, what I know you know where that comes from. So, too much inside jokes, not enough sleep. Okay, here we go. So, wherever you were in the order last time, just flip-flop that, only with less people. Okay, on deck is Joseph. Please welcome Dante back to the stage.
Letter to CEO John Hammond from an unnamed Jurassic Park employee. Dear Mr. Hammond, every day at the beginning of the tour, I answer the same pre-prepared question. Why don't the dinosaurs just break out of the cages? And every day at the beginning of the tour, I give the same pre-prepared answer. We raise them here, and when they we raise them here, and all they know when they grow up is this place. We gave them a sanctuary. See, they like it here. When you grow up in a cage, you don't see the bars. The bars just make up the edges of your world, and outside of those bars, there's nothing. There's no possible way a dinosaur could ever conceive of anything outside of those cage walls. And I hope that the guests believe me when I tell them this. Every morning, my job is to make sure none of the visitor jeeps fall off the tracks. Every morning, I walk the 6.5 miles of railroad track, making sure there are no breaks in the rail or trees falling down. And every morning, I hear them trotting alongside me, just on the other side of the fence. But the cage walls are impenetrable. Right? I mean, this is state-of-the-art technology. It's not going to break. I'm just here to make sure that it won't break, which it won't. See, the dinosaurs hate electricity, and when you get too close to the fences, you get shocked. This is how we teach them the values of staying inside. And at night, I sleep in a bunk in the employee cabin just outside of the Tyrannosaurus range. I hear them sometimes. They moo at night like cows. Because that's all they are, right? These big, domesticated cows with teeth like steak knives and claws like daggers and eyes like bats. They don't see that well, but the stars are mighty bright out here, and I'm sure that they see those. Do they realize how far they are from the stars, Mr. Hammond? Or do they just think of them as another cage? Maybe they've learned what electricity feels like. See, maybe they like the shock. There are creatures mooing at the moon like lost children. Maybe they know that this island only has about 16 square miles of range, and maybe they know that their cages make up about 14 square miles, and maybe they realize that they have more land than us. And what will happen when they realize that we aren't gods? That we were just fumbling with steel and DNA, and maybe we don't know what we were doing when we created life. This isn't Eden. This isn't Adam and Eve. We just reached back into history and pulled dragons with us into the modern age. They aren't breathing fire yet, Hammond. Are you sure they won't breathe fire? And when God breathed life into Adam, was he also afraid of being eaten by his own creation? See, Mr. Hammond, sometimes I don't know who came first. I don't know who built these cages and who lives in them. Mr. Hammond, the cage walls are impenetrable. This is state-of-the-art technology. You will be perfectly safe if you keep your head and arms inside of the cage. I mean, the door. I mean, the vehicle. I mean, the island is perfectly safe. Mr. Hammond, tell me the island is perfectly safe.
Well, what do I say about sticking around for the second round? So worth it. Right? Give yourself the love. Okay, good. Scores for our first official poet in the second round. 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please. Got an 8.7 and an 8.8 and an 8.9 and a 9.5. And a 9.6 for Dante. Thank you, poet.
After
a baby not dinosaur-sized Tina penalty. Okay. On deck is Alex. Please welcome Joseph back to the stage.
I drove by an eye clinic with a sign blinking, reading, "Now accepting new patients." And I thought that was strange, thinking of the alternative, rejecting patients, rejecting care, because the human race has run out of patience for patients. They don't care enough to offer care. It is a race, after all. And if you're not well enough to run, maybe you shouldn't be in the race. What is great about healthcare is most people don't actually care. When my sister was unable to get covered, they would no longer provide her with her inhaler, inhibiting her ability to breathe and to run, falling behind in the human race. Her inhaler helped her lungs work and her chest rise and fall with each breath, not unlike the upper and the lower class, rising and falling with each breath, the gap in the middle growing larger, the gap in teeth getting wider, because who can afford braces when you can't afford rent in a house built up by government cheese bricks? Don't play outside because we can't afford a coat and we can't afford the risks of you getting sick. No time to play outside, no time to run, no running in the race, the human race. In their eyes, there are losers to the race, but not in my eyes. Not in my dad's eye, because he lost one to cancer and a leg to MS, and maybe he can't run, but when it comes to pirate and Mad-Eye Moody costumes, he's always the best. And I'm so thankful for medicine prolonging his life and his breathing and his living, his benefits, that we can afford his medication of a daily use, paying the cost 18 times it takes to produce. Because illness is a cash crop, and those that can't fight back are the perfect people to rob. To them, we're all just ATMs, and each breath comes with a surcharge. And I'm thankful for all the care I have received, all the vaccines, lollipops, band-aids, and stickers, all the nurses and doctors with latex freezing cold fingers. And I'm thankful for their help and their charity, but I'm angry at the people at the top forcing us to compete to race, and I'm demanding for it to stop. We can't give care until we all start caring, and it has to be more than prayers of care that we're willing to be sharing. You can care and help, and this will become a three-legged race. Give patience to patience and try imagining running an already lost race. Wow.
Give that young man a megaphone.
Excellent. All right, scores for Joseph in the second round. 1, 2, 3, up and at me, please, judges. So I've got an 8.5 and a 9.0 and a 9.1 and a 9.4 and a 9.6. You guys are still allowed to make noise. All right, and for those of you playing at home, both rounds count in determining our final winners. So, all right, on deck is Hannah. Please welcome Alex back to the stage.
Dear Mark Wahlberg, it has come to the attention of the public eye that you are requesting a pardon on a crime you committed over 25 years ago. When you're 16, filled with intoxicants and no good Boston street punk, you assaulted two Vietnamese men. Some suggest you only want this pardon so you can obtain a liquor license for your burger restaurant, Wahlburgers, and expand it into California and across the nation. You said you want this pardon because the weight bears too heavy on your body and come on bended knees asking for forgiveness. You know what I think, Mark? I think you are just like me and understand that the perfect burger must come with the perfect drink. If this is all for the love of burgers, I completely get it. If you're biting into one of your famous barbecue bacon burgers topped with white cheddar, bacon, avocado, fresh jalapenos, and barbecue sauce, it is not a complete meal unless you have a frosty beer to go with it. You're just like me. You love burgers that much. What would you recommend with it? I think a clean, crisp pilsner would complement the heaviness and salt and white of the white cheddar and bacon, but what would you pick, Mark? What skull would you crack open? What beer would you crack open to enjoy the burger with? And let me ask you about the patty. You probably press them yourself with hands like yours, so acclimated to grind flesh, to render unconscious, to render the fat, because this pardon is just for the burgers, right? Not because you brutally struck tan lamb with a 5-foot-long wooden plank, leaving him unconscious after spitting Vietnam fucking shit. You were 16. You were drunk. You were high. High off the vision of these burgers, right? Drunk off the amazing Thanksgiving burger you would serve, right? You were trying to rob lamb for the beer he was loading into his store. You just wanted a perfect pairing 25 years in advance. Not because later you found Johnny Trin and assaulted him in the face so viciously that people say you blinded him. It wasn't about that. Or the fact that you was a slant-eyed gook. You were a kid kind of from the mean side of your neighborhood. Things have changed. You have changed. Why does it matter who you were then if you are who you are now? Because you are just like me, and they look just like me. Erase the crimes that you committed completely and never have to face them again. Finally turn the blind eye after all of these years. Say it was for your conscience. Say it was for your soul. Hell, say it was for your budding burger empire and you wanted to make more money. The Daily Mail interviewed one of your victims, Mark. They asked Johnny Trin about the attack, about his eye, and he said, "Oh, he was just a kid. I lost my eye before that in the war. He has my forgiveness. You have his blessing. He doesn't even care. He said he doesn't even know who you are, have seen any of your fucking movies, Mark. He does not care about you. Go on, get your pardon, clean your record, bite into your favorite burger, and taste blood." Yeah.
It's true. I haven't made it back to cows yet, but that's true. Jora does eat some kinds of meat now. All right. Keep focus. Here we go. Scores for Alex in the second round. Up and at me, please. Okay. That's what I got. All right. I've got an 8.8. Boo! And a 9.4. And another 9.4. And a 9.5. And a 10. Yeah. 28.3. All right, what a hot competition. Okay, we just have three poets left. On deck is Toby. Please welcome Hannah back to the stage.
Dude, last night was epic. I can't remember anything. It made the hangover look like amateur hour. Last night went way beyond that. We're talking shredded clothes and missing teeth, and I can feel a tattoo somewhere on my body that makes the phrase tramp stamp want to shrivel up and die. Last night was epic. I woke up this morning and I coughed up sparkles. I have a faint memory of getting in an alleyway fight with a saber-toothed tiger. And I'm pretty sure I won, because I don't think he did. Last night was out of control. It topped every other night so hard it won a heavyweight belt. It was like going to Sasquatch before it was cool. It was like In-N-Out Burger double animal style. Last night was epic. It was like 18 kittens that all want to be your friend and not scratch your eyes out. Last night was epic. It was like finding the prize in the box of Lucky Charms. Like, damn, this must be because I'm Irish. I am so in touch with my heritage right now. Last night was epic. It was like Space Jam and Super Smash Brothers, Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings came together and had a four-way magical child. I can't even explain. Last night was epic. I made more friends than Jennifer Aniston in the 90s. I hung out with Steven Tyler. Or maybe it was Angelina Jolie. I don't remember, but there were freakishly big lips everywhere. Last night was epic. Jay-Z and Beyonce almost broke up arguing over how cool I was last night. Every song they played was my favorite song. I had moves like U-Haul. Michael Jackson had nothing on me. I got down like a bad depression. And they had foam fingers made in the shape of my face because I was everybody's number one last night. It was epic. I did everything I would never do. My phone's recent call list is a sick reminder of my high school yearbook with all of the names of people I tried to impress and none of the names I actually wanted. I tore apart my bucket list and replaced it with a list of things I should have done. Pieced the scraps of my memories together into a Bible and stuffed it into a bottle for future me to read, hopefully a little more carefully than the last one. I made a checkoff list of people I should apologize to, starting with future me, ending with last night's you. Last night was epic, but this morning was a cruel joke. The memories burned the back of my eyelids like the acid of seeing yourself through someone else's eyes another time. Like, was that really me? I'm sure I kissed a stranger or two last night, but I think I would remember if I'd held anybody close enough to this quickly thumping, adrenaline-filled horse weight of a heart that I'd broken a rib. The one thing I didn't do last night was break any ribs. How could they not get broken when everything inside is?
Is that about the last poetry slam? Yeah. Excellent. All right. Scores for Hannah in the second round. Judges, you've got a down, up, and at me, please. Oh, I've got an 8.9 and another 8.9. So that was 2 8.9s and a 9.0, a 9.2, and a 9.4 for Hannah. Let her hear it. Okay. Two poets left in the second round. On deck is Miranda. Please welcome Toby back to the stage.
After a love poem. Last night I dreamt I was a ship, that I was wood and science and canvas sails held together by pitch and 1,000 lengths of rope of various sizes. I was magic harnessed by engineering, a gamble on a horizon of potential, unbroken by the weight of the ocean's sadness. I followed a beacon I could not see above the storm and went on through the night, not knowing that the entire sky had become your heart, and I needn't follow a star, for all the heavens now shined to return us. I wake in the pause, darkness, and you were gone, so I call for you. Like a sailor who has been to sea for many months calls out with a desperate joy at the first sight of land. I call for you like Esau called the name of Jacob after so many years of estrangement. I call for you like Ali called for his destiny. I want Joe Frazier. Let me be measured against myself. I am ready. I am ready. I am ready. I am a fighter, and I have a fighter's heart. Let me defined by naked action, crowned victor or forgotten. I am ready. I call for you like Tony Tone calls straight out the 80s. It feels good to know that you love me. It feels good. It feels so good. Let me hear you say. I call for you the way Stanley called for Stella at the end of Streetcar, hands overflowing with exclamations, fates cut and tattooed with his agony. I call for you as Leslie Wesley called to Buttercup, letting his old reply, as you wish, reveal to her the love she thought she'd lost has been restored and is here. I call for you like Otis Redding calls into the mic. I'll be the moon when the sun goes down, just to let you know that I'm still around. That's how strong my love is. I call for you like Dylan Thomas after so much drink calls his father's name into the tabletop. I call for you in Romeo's mournful whisper, thou art not conquered. Beauty's ensign yet is crimson in thy lips and in thy cheeks, and death's pale flag is not advanced there. I will call for you like Rumi calls for Shams, expectant that he might suddenly just peek his head out from besides the corner. I call for you in that great 70s punk step kink song, Victoria, Victoria. Even though your name is Summer. With my ridiculous heart, I am asking for your hand to return in mind. We have such little time. You have gotten up in the night, left our bed, and I have built an eternity in this absence. This moment is too deep for me to surpass, and too heavy to carry alone, and too long to survive. I am breathless here, and I forget myself without you. Please help me. I get up out of bed in my lucky drawers and find you in the kitchen, nursing a glass of milk, and I watch you until you look up, puzzled by the meaning of my eyes, but I am still sleeping. I dream this wakefully, so that you may come back to me, so I may read you this poem each night, adding a new line each night, until you have fallen asleep each and every night after. Thank you.
Was so poetic.
Oh, if only there was like a dating site for poets and normal people to come together. Bless you. Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3 scores for Tobin in the second round.
Sorry.
I like your buddy system right there. Mm-hmm. Okay, I've got a 9.1. And a 9. And a 9.5. And another 9.5. And a 9.6. And a 9.8 for Toby. Thank you, poet. 28.6. Oh my God. Now that you learned to bow down to the tyrant of time. I know. All right, here we go. Last poet in the last round of the last normal poetry slam till it gets sexy of this whole season. Please welcome Miranda back to the stage.
Amelia, you helped me feel safe enough. I wish I didn't have to write this, but sometimes I forget that I cannot remember and that it pulls at me like a full moon pulls the tide, relentless before receding, relentless and repeating and repeating and repeating. And I do not have the words to tell you how I will never have the words to tell you because I do not have the memories to tell you. And there is a violence in this that I cannot forget. And so I take solace in the no's I can remember because those are the easiest wounds to heal, easy like knowing where to place the tourniquet because you can see the blood. And after all of these years, shame, she has saved herself for me, and she comes to me asking 1,000 questions, but I do not have the answers because I never had the power to even try to save myself. And shame, she weaves stories to fill spaces like spiders weave webs. And she fills the blanks with 1,000 what-ifs, with 100 faces, with hands and bodies I will never know, with potentialities I wish I could rewrite. But the unknowns have an uncanny way of settling in like poorly fixed bones. And the pain is there to remind you that you cannot forget what you cannot remember. But I must confess, I can remember waking up. I can remember that the skinned knees of my childhood had just barely healed. I can remember waking up and finding seafoam. I can remember confusion. I can remember listening to a doctor teach me about spermicide. Sitting in her office, remembering waking up, being terrified of that foam. I cannot remember ever feeling safe enough to write this. I am still afraid of waking up. When will women ever feel safe enough that we don't have to write this? I wish I didn't have to write this. I have never been able to set the tourniquet. So I just keep praying that someday the bleeding will stop.
Thank you all for your bravery. Scores for Miranda in the second round. Up and at me, please. Got a 9.0 and a 9.2, a 9.4, a 9.5, and another 9.5. Thank you. Thank you, poets. Okay, so.
So
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, wait.
Been done. Woo! And now, bless that Excel sheet I made when I still remembered how to use it. Seriously. Okay, here we go. In third place tonight, please give one more warm round of applause to Miranda. In second place tonight, I bet y'all wish you could marry him too, Toby! Woo!
Have a good one.
Thank you. Thank you, Summer. And in first place tonight, there we go, the big slap. For the second time in 2 years, the Eugene Poetry Slam Grand Slam champion, Alex Dang! Okay, so listen, for those of you who might be feeling sad, like this is the last event, but it's not really, because next month, we've got the Eugene Poetry Slam Sexy Slam. So please come see us again next month, read to us, bring your awesome props, bring your materials, whatever you need, and we will send this event out with a bang for the summer, okay? Thank you so much to the store staff. Remember to give them your money on the way out. Thank you to our wonderful videographer. Thank you to our scorekeeper, Roxy, who holds it down all night. Thank you, judges. Thank you, poets. And thank you to our incredible feature, Ella Barton.